we got here. And one of the things, there he is, that Doug Swisher and Carl Richards wrote a very important book called Selective Trout, in which they created what you can't see it, called the No Hackle Dry Fly. That's one of their creations. Really, really important landmark work was called Selective Trout. Doug Swisher was one of the co-authors of that. A little later on, these folks came. This is Charles Waterman, who is probably my main outdoor writing hero. As far as a writer, an outdoor writer, he's just about my favorite. He and his wife, Phoebe, came up to fish the bow. And Charlie wrote a story in Gray's Sporting Journal about fishing on the river. And we became quite good friends after that. Which is kind of a theme, I guess, that could run through in all this, is the way that some of these people you meet fishing become lifelong friends in many cases. I'm sure you're already aware of that. These are shots of some of the clients that we had through those years. This is a young guy, his name was Ron Kennedy, and I don't know, he was probably 12 or 14 at the time, and he lived in Arizona, and his family had connections in Alberta, and they'd come up every summer, and every summer his dad would buy him a float trip with me on the boat. And so for quite several years in a row, this young guy and I fished together, and I've lost touch with him. I haven't heard from him for a long time, but that's one of the folks we've met. This is an early picture of the guy on the right. His name is, sitting down, his name is Bill Kahn. He's from Pennsylvania, and I think he along with another guy you'll see in a minute, came to fish the bow the first time in about 1980, and came every year for 25 straight years to fish the bow. And then they missed a few years, and then they came back last year. I fished with them again last year. So it has kind of a pull on folks. This is a guy from San Francisco who came many years to fish the river. We didn't have those sissy tables and chairs and things either for lunchtime back in the old days. And that's my friend Jim Gilson. That's the other guy that came up in 1980. Fish the river, and he's the one of the guys that came 25 straight years. Okay, now why are we doing this? A man from Ithaca, New York. His name is Stan Shepherdson. He was a professor of agricultural engineering at Cornell University in Ithaca. And met me the way most of these guys did. He hired me one day, and I guided him. And after that, we just became friends. And I guess maybe you lose some business that way, I don't know, but you sure gained some friendship. And for many, many years, Stan came up with his wife and their other friend, Catherine Kellogg, and we had some great times on the bow. Well, that doesn't look a bit different, does it? I mean, those of you know the river know exactly where that is. It doesn't really look much different. And at some point, this critter arrived, sometime in the 80s. The San Juan worm showed up. I think some fishermen from Montana brought it up and started fishing with it. Of course, it caught fish like crazy. It still does. It was probably even better when it was new because the fish hadn't seen it. And it always kind of bothered me a little bit, not because I think there's anything wrong with fishing with it, but because I had known for a long time that there were these little aquatic worms that lived in the river, but I didn't bother to do anything about imitating them. If I could have figured out how to tie something like that before anybody else showed up with this, I could have been a big hero. But I just, I don't know, I never bothered. But the San Juan worm showed up and became the number one nymph. And there's people around this time, this is sort of mid-80s, late-80s, people were fishing nymphs more, and the implicators and all that sort of stuff were becoming popular. The San Juan worm is sort of the lead fly in that movement, I guess. And then the pelicans showed up. Pelicans weren't always here. In the early years, we never saw pelicans. I don't know when they arrived. It would have been sometime in the 80s, as they did a number of perch streams throughout the West. And this is, too bad I don't have a better shot of them, but that's in the background. In the foreground, that's my wife Linda. In the background, that's Barry White, who I think is sitting right over here a while ago, who was guiding on the river then and it still is. So he was one of the main characters in the river. I guess what we're in now is just some of the characters we associate with the river. That's the guy on the left, that's Lee Perkins again, one of his later trips to fish the bow. And the guy on the right, his name is Tyler Thomas. He was a a guy who used to come up and guide every summer for, five or six years. Tyler came up, lived in Oregon, just loved the bow, came up and guided here in the summers and go back to guiding steelhead fishermen in Oregon the rest of the year. Here's Gord Ball. I mentioned Gord earlier. Kind of lost touch with him, unfortunately, over the years, although I'm sure he's still around. There's Bob Scammell, who's still around. Bob and I used to fish the river a time or two, maybe every year or so. A more recent shot of Bob with a good fish. This would be about the time that I started dyeing my hair, I guess. And some of you get a kick out of this. Anybody know who this is? That's Mike Gifford, who is now the owner of Country Pleasure. Some of you know, Mike. He was probably 17 or something at the time. Mike guided for us in the early days. And this is, we went fishing one time. He was then, as now, a very, very keen, hardcore fisherman. And he made me go out fishing a weir one time, I remember. Just stand here right on the ice. This is Amos Garrett, the famous musician, the famous guitar player who lives in High River now. At this point, he was still, I think, living in the Bay Area of California, and coming to through Calgary once in a while on a tour, and every time he came through town, he could stop and fish. He now lives in High River, but he's one of the characters you can associate with the bow. John Sinnell, the man in the middle, now lives in Vancouver. He's become quite a celebrated photographer in Vancouver. There's John with a nice brown trout. And that's Barry Mitchell, the owner and publisher of the Alberta Fishing Guide. He would never admit it, but Barry used to like to fish the bow once in a while. He spends most of his time in central Alberta these days, but he certainly spent his time on the bow. There's Eric Grinnell again, a little later on. And this is one of the characters of the river. This is my former partner, Don Cahoon. He was in the Country Pleasures with me as a partner for many years. And the old fart, as he was referred to. If you're talking about Don Cahoon and you refer to him as the old fart, it's not an offensive term. With other people it might be, but it's not. And there's Dee Shatani, who was for a long time the Sage rep in Alberta and is now part of the Country Pleasures team. And he took me out one day and taught me how to catch fish in the wintertime. What he didn't tell me is that we were going to catch whitefish, which is what he's got there. And somewhere along the line, this would have been in the 80s, they started studying the river. And this is significant because somewhere in here we finally got a chapter of Trout Unlimited in Calgary. And gradually, it's taken basically this whole period from 1970 till, say, 2000 or so, to where it's reached a point that the river is being managed by intent rather than by simple good fortune. I mean, there was never, for a long time, never any particular special attention or special study given the river. But finally, it just over time, the government agencies realized that there was something of value here. Maybe we should learn a little bit about it. And this is one of the early, maybe the first electrofishing trip they took down the river. Again, I don't know what the year was. It would be in the 80s, I think. And this was spearheaded by the then regional fisheries biologist. His name was Bill Griffiths, who is no longer with us. But he's the one that they named the creek after up at Canmore with brown trout's pond, Bill Griffiths Creek. This is Bill is in this boat here somewhere. One of the guys throwing the pro. And there's one of the, if you've never seen an electrofish, it's pretty interesting. They haul up a lot of fish. And in fact, on this trip, we were on the same stretch of river, which is generally not a good idea. Because at least you don't want to follow them. If you're ahead of them, it's okay. But there's going to be a lot of disturbed fish if you're following behind them. But we found it pretty interesting. So we sort of tagged along and watched what they were doing. So there's one of the buckets of fish that they got. And then what they do is they tag and then they measure them and they record them and then they go back and try and recapture them and they can thereby kind of extrapolate a population estimate, which is still, I think, basically the way that they do the population studies in the river. And this particular day they did catch a very big bull trout in the bow. I think it was the only one they caught. And that's Bill Griffiths there, not that you can tell. So there he is. He was a little over 30 inches, I think, in a big, big healthy bull. But that's kind of when they started to study the river with efforts to try and regulate it to preserve it. And we're far better off that way now than we were back then, because, as I said, it was just nothing more than good fortune to maintain the river's quality through the early years. This is George McBride, who still guides a bit on the bow, and guided a lot on the bow for a while, and I think is probably fishing for fun more these days. There's Bruce Goodall, who is an influential guy in the early stages of Trout Unlimited in Calgary. He was, I can't remember whether he was an early president or what he was, but I know that he did a lot of work to kind of make sure that Trout Unlimited got off the ground in Calgary when it first started. There's Bruce. And there's Rick Harding, a longtime friend of mine, and who was actually the first president of the Bull River chapter of Trout Unlimited. Rick will be here at the show. I don't know if he's here today, but he's doing some fly tying presentations. He's a terrific tier and a very good instructor. And I don't know if you should probably put it on your calendar, try and catch one of his tying presentations, because they're really good. And then you can say, I hear you were the first president of the Bull River chapter to you, and he'll be impressed. Here's more recent pictures. This is one of the Trout Unlimited fish roundups. Some of you probably been involved in those. You ever done that? The fish that escape from the river into the irrigation canals through the summer, and then come fall, they shut off the canals and the fish are trapped. So every year, the Trout Unlimited, really throughout southern Alberta, they go and they get big groups of volunteers, and they catch the fish that would just die in the canals and put them back in the river. And it's been quite an ongoing program. Jeff, how long has that been going on?
10 years.
More than 10 years? Oh, yeah, okay. You got any idea how many fish you move? 100,000 fish a year get basically rescued from a canal and put back in the river where they belong. So it's been a good project. Okay. A fish is a fish. Next year he'll be more than an inch long, as opposed to dead. Okay, just a little bit of some family stuff here. That's my wife and daughter. That's one of my daughter's earliest float trips, I guess. I see she's wearing her 101 Dalmatian waders again. She's a little older. She's really grown up with fly fishing and has become very, very competent, very capable with it. And has now been married for 3 years. So that's where all that goes. There's Dave Brown, another character on the river. Dave, these days, does most of his guiding over in southeastern BC. He spent some time on the river, for sure, on the boat. I think we're about running near the end here. So I guess one of the great things about this is the fact that, you know, if we consider that this program started with at October the 10th, 1970, and here we are in July or January the 29th, 2011, what's that, 40 years, a little over 40 years, that we're still talking about a river that's a great trout stream. That's pretty good, because I think if you'd, you know, asked most of us in 1980 or so, well, what do you think this will be like in 30 more years, we probably would have said, I don't know, we'll be lucky if it's still here, you know, because the city was growing, the oil stuff was going on, and I think in 1970, what was the population of Calgary? 200? 250, something like that, yeah. So I think it's in some ways we should feel good that we've still got what we've got, and we should feel good because it's being watched much more carefully than it ever was before. So that's, I think that's it. So if anybody's got any questions about this, I told you I wouldn't teach you how to catch more fish. So, I'm pretty sure I kept my word, but thanks for coming by. If you got any questions now, that's great.